And join with me in singing our opening hymn, O God, Almighty Father, found in music issue number 698, number 698.
Jesus, you are the eternal Son of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you come in word and sacrament to save your people. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you sent your Holy Spirit to bring light and peace to the world. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
Trinity of eternal glory, and adore your unity, powerful in majesty, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses said to the people, "Ask now of the days of old, before your time, ever since God created man upon the earth. Ask from one end of the sky to the other, did anything so great ever happen before? Was it ever heard of? Did a people ever hear the voice of God speaking from the midst of fire as you did and live? Or did any God venture to go and take a nation for himself from the midst of another nation by testings, by signs and wonders, by war, with strong hand and outstretched arm, and by great terrors, all of which the Lord, your God, did before you in Egypt, before your very eyes? This is why you must now fix your heart, and you must now know and fix your heart that the Lord is God, in the heavens above and on earth below, and there is no other. You must keep his statutes and commandments that I enjoin on you today, that you and your children after you may prosper, and that you may have long life on the land which the Lord your God is giving you forever." The word of the Lord. Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, through whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if only we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. The word of the Lord.
Teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always until the end of the age. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
When I was teaching in summer, sometimes I'd help parishes to give the pastor a break for vacation. Not that I didn't need one, but anyway. I remember once going to a place, I was there for a month, and they had, I think it was twice a month, a mass in a county jail. And so I would go to a place that had fundamentalist Baptist chaplains who were kind of running the ins and outs of the place. And they were not very welcoming to Catholics, especially Catholic priests. And one day, one of them says to me, you know, the word Trinity is not in this Bible. No point in arguing, let me tell you. So my response is, neither is the word pulpit that you do not stop banging your Bible upon. Not a great day for ecumenism, but anyway. And it's true, the word Trinity is not in the Bible, but the substance of Trinity is all through the Bible. And what we know is that our understanding of God as being triune, it emerges from the people throughout the centuries who had an experience of God, who was made known to them and as triune. And we see that today's reading certainly express the threeness of God. And that it's in the scriptures, they're witnesses. The scriptures witness to what the people experience in salvation history. And of course, today's with that understanding that comes from that initial experience witnessed to in the scripture, that led to questioning of faith. How could God be one? The monotheistic religion is of that of the Jews, the Christians, and Muslims alike. Monotheism. And to try to understand that mystery, it moves from scripture to the faith-seeking understanding, basically. And that the Trinitarian doctrine of the church does not come to true form until 381. That's a long time of rumination. But it's ultimately the praying church that experienced God as three, they've come to an understanding after years. but it's the experience is first spoken in Deuteronomy today. First, there was Israel, and Israel's coming to see that the maker of the universe, the creator, is the one they call Adonai, or Yahweh, and who rescued them from slavery not once but twice, first in Egypt and then in Babylon. And that first reading today marvels. What other God has done to this? What other God's voice has been heard by others, by us, through a fire, and has continued to live? And this unimaginable creator of all has chosen them from all of the nations. What a marvel it is for them. Then how did God, the same God, became fully revealed as in Jesus of Nazareth? How that divine revelation impacts Christian lives in the power of the Holy Spirit? We get a glimpse of that in Paul's letter to the Romans, the little bit that we read today. And in that reading, what he does is he addresses Christian transformation. What happens by becoming converted to Christ, by being anointed with his Spirit in baptism? And Jesus, Paul compares this, their status as Christians, to what happens when a Roman household slave becomes an adopted son. And this is a practice Paul is writing to the Romans, and knowing the Roman customs, which really didn't happen in Judaic, or very infrequently Judaic households. In the social world of Paul, a childless couple desiring an heir would commonly adopt a favored servant. And thus, a former servant suddenly becomes a member of the family. And what is more, that servant would become an heir to the estate. And that was a tremendous change. And so seeing this and comparing it to what happens through baptism is that we're no longer a slave. We are now a son or a daughter, an heir to that household, the household of God. And being an heir to that household was to be a brother to the first heir of the household, Jesus. And the estate was his living in glory. And it's also a share in his suffering, as Paul says. It's part of being a child of God as we embrace our identity as such through the Holy Spirit. And what we see in this is when one finds oneself suddenly a son or a daughter of God, a brother or sister of the Son of God, is enabled by the Spirit of God to call the same God of all creation in that intimate way that Jesus does, Abba, Father. Thus, the church, it begins to pray in this, in its liturgy, to the Father, through the Son, and in the Holy Spirit. And that's the very earliest liturgy that we're aware of. We pray to the Father, through the Son, and in the Holy Spirit. And how do we do it today? Our prayers to the Father, through the Son, united in the Holy Spirit. Our Christian prayer, especially our Eucharistic worship, is not simply an act of faith, but rather it's a response to the revelation of God in Jesus Christ, who empowers us with the gift of the Spirit to continue the mission of Jesus. And that's what's going on in today's gospel. The risen Lord appears to the 11. And what it speaks to is that, first of all, today's gospel is not merely a mandate to perform the baptism with a ritual with the three divine names. We baptize with water in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So it's not merely giving us that ritual in which to baptize people. It is also a commission to form communities. To form communities who respond to the love of God revealed in Jesus by living the life of the Spirit. And that life of the Spirit is also taught in the Sermon on the Mount. And if you recall, the Sermon on the Mount are not just the Beatitudes, but to forgive one another. If you you have something against someone, bring it to the altar, bring your offering. First make peace, then bring your offering to the altar. Turn the other cheek. In any way, it's calls for honesty. When you mean yes, say yes. When you mean no, say no. Faithfulness, fidelity in relationships, marital relationships, and all relationships. To live justly and to be nonviolent, turn the other cheek, and forgiveness. Living those is living in the Spirit of Jesus Christ. And very importantly, Jesus, at the end of this story, he tells his disciples, and know that I am with you always until the end of the ages. And very often in baptism, when a couple brings their child to be baptized, a family brings their child to be baptized, that part of the baptism, that's just the beginning of their life. Teach them all that I have commanded you to do. And this is perhaps the most important. And to remember that I am with you always till the end of the age. The Spirit of Jesus dwells within us, and we're called to depend on him, call upon him, to strengthen us to be witnesses, witnesses to the love of God poured out in Jesus Christ. And we're enabled and empowered to do that by the Holy Spirit. And not just when children are young, but throughout our lives, throughout their lives. Not only to be witness to our children, but to be witnesses to the world of that love of God poured out for us. And it is the Spirit that enables us and empowers it even to forgive. Jesus' assurance that he is always with us, we bring the prayerful concerns of our hearts.
That all who are baptized in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit live out our call to holiness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That people of all nations may treat God's creation as holy and worthy of care, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who have died in their country's service be remembered with respect and gratitude, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the Holy Spirit breathe freshness and renewal among all who are tired, discouraged, and downhearted, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the members of this faith community be a reflection of the Most Holy Trinity's life-giving vitality, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our beloved dead may receive the reward of eternal life, especially that our beloved dead may receive the reward of eternal life, especially Jack Yomi and Patricia Dion, in whose memory this Eucharist is celebrated, and for our most recently departed, Bob Amends. May they be admitted to the company of the saints, and may those who mourn their loss be comforted. We pray to the Lord. Let us pause for a moment of silence to pray for the needs we hold close to our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Triune God, giver of all that is good, hear the prayers of those you love and grant them in your holy name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave this cup to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And
let's offer some sign of our peace in Christ.
Thank you.
We have just a couple of announcements today. The first is that the Council of Catholic Women will meet in prayer on Friday, June 4th for daily Mass, and will then pray the Divine Mercy Chaplet found in Mass. The funeral for Bob Amond is Thursday, June 10th at 10 o'clock. Father's Day Masses during the weekend of June 19 and 20, the Masses in our church will be offered for the fathers whose names are placed on the altar. Remembrance cards and cards to give to fathers are located in the narthex and in the parish hall. Please leave today's missals and music issues in the church pews so they can be utilized by our parishioners at other Masses. Thank you. And then one further announcement is, if you recall, for those of you who were here last week, our two veteran altar servers, Jacob and Paul, they're moving to Georgia, so they're no longer serving. But here we have today with us Christopher, who is our newest altar server, and the true veteran, Emma. Coordinates all of the scheduling of altar servers and trains altar servers, and I'm very grateful to her for all that work. Let us pray. May receiving this sacrament, O Lord our God, bring us health of body and soul as we confess your eternal